And now, from the great state of Mississauga in Ontario, Canada, it's the Ted Wallachin Podcast. Brought to you by ETP Canada, providing estate administration with ease. ETP Canada. And Tom's Place, for the finest in men's fashion. Tom's Place will suit you. And now, here's Ted.
In 1970, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, one of the hottest rock bands in North America, set out for an 11-show, 26-day concert tour. But unlike other tours, this one was so much different. First, it was not by choice. And secondly, it would take place in Romania, Yugoslavia, and Poland. In other words, behind the Iron Curtain, where their music was banned. It was a tour that would alter the future for the band, propelling them into a downward spiral.
What goes up must come down. Spinning wheel, got to go round. Talking about your troubles, it's a crying sin. Ride a painted pony, let the spinning wheel spin.
What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears chronicles this fascinating piece of rock history. The documentary is on now at Ted Rogers Hot Dog Cinema and is produced and directed by my guest, John Scheinfeld. John, welcome. It's a real pleasure to chat with you. I thank you for taking the time.
Thanks for having me, Ted. Glad to be here.
Let me ask you, this is such a bizarre story. This is one of those, come on, you're making this up stories, but it isn't a making it up story. It's true. Let me ask you first, who approached the band about this tour, and how did they go about selling the idea?
Well, the situation all began, Ted, with a problem. Yeah. The problem was that the band's lead singer, David Clayton Thomas, was Canadian. That in and of itself is not a problem, but it was
a, I was going to say, damn Canadians.
Yeah. It became a problem because somebody in Washington was not happy with him speaking out against Richard Nixon and the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. And suddenly he began to have immigration problems. And from what we were able to learn, the first time this popped up was in June of 1969. David, there was a break in the band schedule. David had come back to Toronto, and he was supposed to then come back to the United States for the band's appearance at the Newport Jazz Festival on July 4th of 69. Mm. And he gets to the airport and the Canadian authorities won't let him out because the American authorities won't let him in. So this was the first inclination that there was some issue going on here. The Newport Jazz Festival intervened. They had somebody in the Nixon administration who could help. And so David was allowed back into the country, but this became an ongoing problem, his work visa.
Yeah.
And so Blood, Sweat, and Tears got a new manager in September of 69, who properly said, I have to be proactive and solve this problem. We're not exactly sure if he reached out to the State Department or if the U.S. State Department reached out to him. But eventually what happened was a quid pro quo deal where the State Department would make David's immigration problems go away. And in return, the band, which was the hottest band, one of the hottest bands going at that point, would do a tour on behalf of the State Department. And It worked.
But it wasn't a typical USO tour. They were going behind the Iron Curtain. Yeah, and their music was not even allowed to be played there.
That's correct. It really was not a USO tour. It was sponsored by the State Department. And the State Department had targeted three countries, then Yugoslavia, Romania, and Poland, as countries that they could perhaps develop a relationship with. Mm-hmm. And they thought that by sending over one of the biggest bands at the time, that they could help open up those countries to conversations with the West. And so Blood, Sweat, and Tears became the very first American rock band to perform behind the Iron Curtain.
Right. And so when the band heard about this, how did they react? I realize there's nine of them, so it's nine different reactions, but in general.
Yeah, I think it was a bit mixed. There were some like Steve Katz, the guitar player, who was a very political individual, really didn't want to do it. Some of the other members were agnostic about it, and then some really felt, hey, we have no choice here. We're not going to have a band if David is deported and cannot work in the United States. Mm-hmm. So in some ways, Ted, I think it was how they felt was almost irrelevant. They really, in essence, were blackmailed into doing this tour. They had to do it or they were going to lose their singer. That was a very practical issue here.
Yeah. What would have happened if it had been one of the other members of the band? Obviously not Bobby Columbia, because he owned the band, right? He was too big. But any of the, maybe the secondary players of the band, do you think they would have said, sorry, we got to let you go?
But because it's, it was a lead singer? Yeah, it's an interesting speculation. I would say probably the odds were better that they wouldn't have done the tour then. They wouldn't have had that big problem. Mm-hmm. Guitar players, horn players, all of those people are a lot more replaceable than the voice of the band. Yeah. David was such a great singer and such an identifiable sound for that band that I think that's why it became the issue.
Now, so when you're preparing for a tour, typically you're going to Chicago, you're going to Dallas, you're going to L.A., you're going up west here in Canada to Vancouver. You know what you're up for. You have no idea what you're entering when you're headed to what was then, as you say, Yugoslavia, Romania, and Poland, and all you know is what you read in books, and some of it is fanciful and some of it is factual. How did they go about preparing for this kind of a tour?
Two things. The State Department had them in for an orientation, for two orientations, actually, in terms of here's what you can expect, here's how you should think about behaving, and here are some of the things that you might encounter. But I think, Ted, it's like when you read a book in school, they can tell you intellectually everything that you need to know, but it really is different once you're on the ground. And, it's interesting. One of my film heroes is Alfred Hitchcock.
Nice.
And in many of his films, the general plot line is innocent person gets enveloped into international intrigue, not of their own making, and has to figure out a way to get through it.
Yeah.
And I think in many ways, that's the situation with Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Here they are, nine innocent musicians, if you will. They're not a political band, particularly. They've never been to that part of the world. Like most young people in 1970, they are anti-war and anti-Nixon, but not vociferously so. And so here they are, swept up into this international intrigue, and they have to figure out how to get through and survive. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really what it became. So they fly over, and first stop is Yugoslavia, and then Romania, and then Poland. And I think each of them, it's not a monolith, the Iron Curtain. Each country had their own personality and their own cultural specifics, and they had to figure out what those were and then how to deal with it. But what they do have is that in each of those countries, there was an American embassy with State Department staff. And so they were there to help guide as best they could the band through what they were going to encounter.
Right. And fortunately for the band, those people and their children from the State Department would be familiar with Blood, Sweat, and Tears and would be familiar with their music. But the vast majority of their audience may not even heard any of their music. How do you prepare yourself to perform in front of a house of people who are anxious to see you but have no idea what to expect?
Yeah, I think on one hand, it's got to be very strange to go there and perform for people who don't know you. But on the other hand, these guys perform like, 6-7 days a week. They're used to giving a concert. They are, in essence, giving their usual show. And so I don't know that it really had any effect in that way. What we do know, for example, is that some of the young people behind the Iron Curtain were able to hear rock music on Voice of America or Radio Free Europe, one of those services. So they might have been exposed to it a little bit. Somebody might have smuggled in an album somewhere. But largely, they did not know the band, but they appreciated what the band represented was the energy and the freshness of rock music, and because that music generally had been banned by the communist authorities,
right?
And so, but then it's also American and Western, and that represented freedom to them. And we spend a lot of time in What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears talking about just what these concerts represented to the young people over there. But, you know, Ted, we were just talking about intellectual versus actually experiencing. Yeah. And so it'd be one thing for the band members or our experts in the film to talk about how the young people responded to these concerts. But I really wanted to track down some people that were at those concerts who could speak firsthand to how they felt about it. And we hired researchers in those countries. And thank heaven for social media, they were able to track down some folks that were at those concerts. And when you see them in 2023 talking about what these concerts meant to them 50 years ago, you can just tell just how significant this was for them. It wasn't just a rock concert. It meant something so much more. And to hear these people talk about it is one of the great things in our film from my point of view.
John Scheinfeld is the producer and director of What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears, a documentary which is currently airing at the Hot Dog Cinema, the Ted Rogers Hot Dog Cinema here in Toronto. Did the State Department send along a film crew with the band?
State Department did not, but the band had contracted with an independent production company based in Hollywood to film the tour with the idea of making a 2-hour documentary for distribution in cinemas around the world, because Blood, Sweat, and Tears was big enough to warrant that. And so the film crew came along with them, shot 65 hours of footage, and then they came back to Los Angeles to edit this. And therein began another problem, which we can talk about. But this documentary never came out. And, you know, when I start film.
Why did it not come out?
We talk a lot about that in the film. The State Department was concerned about some of the things that might have been captured on film by the film crew, that they might make some of these governments, specifically Romania and Poland, might somehow make them look bad and then impact these relationships that the State Department was trying to build with those governments. And in fact, that is true.
Yeah.
And so the producers were really unable to satisfy the State Department. And based on what we have learned from declassified government documents, we believe the State Department stopped the release of this film. But then somebody thought, well, let's try a shorter version that the State Department could use overseas, but also that we could sell to television. So they cut a shorter version, a 1-hour version. And the 65 hours of raw material and the 2-hour version totally vanished. We have not been able to find those anywhere. It's a big mystery and the bane of my existence that we can't find these things.
I guess.
But we talk about in the film what we think happened. But what we did find, buried in a vault here in Hollywood, we found a pristine print of that 1-hour version. And that provides all the lost footage that we do have that makes the foundation of What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Right, because as a documentarian, when you take a project on, I would assume that the first thing you got to do is think to yourself, okay, where are the raw materials? Where are the pictures? Where are the stills? Where are the moving pictures? Where do we have any sound? Do we have any witnesses? Do we have any of that information? And that makes up, I suppose, as a documentarian, that might be the most exciting part of your job in a strange way, even though it's probably the most frustrating.
It's a little bit of both.
Yeah.
But it's a part of the job I love. It's the detective work where you have to track stuff down. On the photo side, quite early on, we were very lucky. all the band members and some of the other people who had been on the tour with them took a lot of photographs, and they gave mm-hmm. us access to that. So we had hundreds and hundreds of photographs. And so you'll see a lot, your listeners will see a lot of that in the film. So that was great. But we had to find this film footage. And as I just described, we were able to find some. So that was really, really good. But then we needed other third-party footage and things to help tell the story. And we did find, for example, TV footage that was shot in Yugoslavia that had been buried in a vault over in Yugoslavia since the 50s. And so
wow.
the 70s. So we found that. We found some German documentary footage taken around that same time that helped us. So there was a lot of detective work by yeah. me and my team. And the result is very evident in the film.
Now, in the meantime, there's another stumbling block that you don't normally run into when you're producing a documentary. And in your case, it was COVID. You couldn't go anywhere. You couldn't travel into Canada, or David couldn't go from Canada into the States because of COVID regulations. And it's just getting around and trying to meet with people and do interviews and do prep was extremely difficult and held you up for a long time.
It did. We began this pre-production in April of 2020, so just after COVID started. And mm-hmm. so, yes, we were unable to travel to interview band members or our experts, and we were not able to get to Toronto to interview David Clayton Thomas at first. And so we were doing a lot of work that we could do without being able to travel. But it was a little bit more than that, Ted, because a lot of the archives and libraries and sources for material that we normally use, a lot of them were closed, and you could yeah. not get to them either. So we had some difficulty there, but eventually, as COVID began to be handled and people started to come back to work, even if it was just a few days a week, we were able to get what we needed. And I remember it was suddenly Canada opened to us Americans, and it was going to be open for at least a few weeks. So it was like, get on a plane and come, because we don't know, you know, how long that window is going to be open.
Yeah.
So we came up and shot a wonderful interview with David in your city. And he's great in the film, and as is everyone else. And it just was a matter of finding the time and getting a little cooperation from COVID.
Whose idea was it to do this documentary, and who approached you?
It's all Bobby Colombi's fault. he was the original drummer, co-founder of the band, and uh-huh. he became the band leader. And we had met 5 or 6 years ago. He had come to see a screening of a film I made called Chasing Train about the iconic jazz musician John Coltrane. And he really loved it, and he wanted to meet, so we went and we had lunch and got acquainted, but that was really it. And then literally about 2 months before COVID hit, Bobby called me and he says, I want to take you to lunch again. I have a story I want to tell you. And so we went to lunch and we were just sort of talking about how much I love the band, because I got introduced to them in high school and just thought, this is a great sound. Yeah. And I said, what the hell happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears? Here you guys were the hottest band going, and then you weren't. What happened? He said, well, that's the story I'm going to tell you.
Yeah.
And he gave me just the rough outline of it, because Bobby didn't have all the details. He just sort of knew the general story. And I'm like, wow, this is really, I had not heard anything about this. And I did a little bit of research, and there wasn't much out there about it. And so as a filmmaker, you always love a story that people have not heard before or isn't readily available sure. online. And so I just thought, this is great. And I came up with a vision for the film, how I wanted to tell the story. Bobby was very supportive. And then we went off and found a financier who loved the band and loved the story. And he financed the whole film, and we were off and running.
I would imagine with a title like What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears, that would, if I had the money, I'd buy it right there. just strictly from the title, because it's one of those questions, you're right, where thousands of people have asked themselves over the years, well, what the hell ever happened? It's like you ask that about actors and stuff, right?
Yeah, exactly right. And it's really funny, as we've been out doing some press for the film, and We opened in New York last weekend, and we took some questions after the screenings, and a lot of people had the same question as you were just saying, and so we're answering it for me and for a lot of other people as well.
Yeah. When you travel to faraway places that you're unfamiliar with, places that are not democracies as we know them, it tends to change people. How did the guys of the band change after they came back from the tour?
Excellent question. They went off, I think, having some of the same viewpoints that the counterculture in the West had. That between the war and Nixon and all that, everything that was going on in the world, there's a better system out there somewhere than Western democracy. And, you know, it's probably better over there because we're having such a hard time here.
Yeah.
But what they discovered is that living in an authoritarian state under a dictator is no fun.
Yeah.
And they witnessed that firsthand. You know, there are people today in America on the right who support Putin, think Putin is great, and what he's doing is fine. And let me tell you that, as we show you in our film, those kind of dictators are not worthy of our support or affection, as some of our former presidents had for them. These are bad guys who do bad things, and those countries are very difficult to live in. And the band members saw this firsthand. And when they came back, they were just honestly asked, what did you learn over there? And they honestly responded, you know, for those of us that thought maybe there's a better system out there, there's not.
Yeah.
And they got into trouble for having that point of view.
Yeah. Well, in general, people think, I've seen pictures I've seen pictures of Poland and Yugoslavia and Romania. And it looks like people are enjoying their lives there. Well, of course, those are the pictures that are released by the government, only by the government. And then suddenly you arrive and you're stunned to see how impoverished the people really are and how they're in restraints. I mean, they can't think out loud. They certainly can't speak out loud.
We talk a lot about that, Ted, particularly in Romania, where the government control of behavior, thoughts, everything was so strong. The band would, for example, if they met somebody on the street and tried to engage them in conversation, the people would just sort of run away because they would have to report this, or someone might report them for having a conversation. It really was a very paranoid state, and you saw that a lot. And the band members told me that from time to time, when there was a quiet moment, if the people there were a little fearless, they would come up and say, can you give me some money for a plane ticket? Can you help get me out of the country? You know, whatever. Yeah. They were just so desperate to get out from under the clutches of these repressive governments.
There was a documentary made about a year ago here in Canada, which focused in on a hockey series between Team Canada and the Soviet national hockey team in 1972. So just a couple of years after Blood, Sweat, and Tears went, they played four games in Canada, four games in Moscow. And some of the footage shows the Russian players in Toronto, and you can see them, they're going into places like blue jean shops, and they're buying jeans, and they go into record stores, and they're loading up with all these albums that you can't get when you're here. And then conversely, they talk to some of the hockey players, the Canadians, who talk about, my God, we were so shocked to see how poor Moscow was. You know, how as you fly in the evening, there's just barely any lights on in these apartment buildings because they can't afford the electricity. And the way that these people live, and the way that you're treated by people, and how they spy on you. And I would imagine that they have exactly the same situation with the guys when they went over.
Oh, very much so. We spend a lot of time in the film talking about their experiences with the foreign secret police and the intelligence services. And we also have a little fun with it because in retrospect, the band members could look back and find some humor in them being under surveillance. But at the time, I think it was quite scary. That the local authorities would go through their luggage, would have them under surveillance. The rooms would be would have microphones, all that sort of thing that you see in spy movies or read in the best spy novels. But it's in those places because it happens, and the band really experienced that.
I would imagine overall, though, of the concerts that they performed at, they must have been standing ovation after standing ovation.
Yes. In many places, they couldn't get off the stage because the audience got so excited about this music. And that, in fact, became the problem in Bucharest, in Romania, that the audience got so excited. The authorities got very, very concerned and at one point set out dogs to control the crowd and beat up some young people who were getting a little too enthusiastic. And it was sort of sad to see that. But yes, the concerts themselves were very well received. And again, going back to the detective work, we knew that the band and the production company had taken along with them a portable 8-track tape recorder, not the kind that used to be in people's cars, but a portable studio machine.
Yeah, maybe.
And they recorded all the concerts. So I'm like, all right, where are those tapes? You know, the idea was, of course, that that would be part of the film that never happened. So we think most of those tapes are wherever that 65 hours of footage went. Yeah. But I have a wonderful researcher named Kathleen who is very sweet, but also very persistent. And she ended up tracking down the family of the associate producer of that documentary that never came out. He had died in 2018, but the family had donated the contents of a storage unit to the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences Library here in Los Angeles. And it had just been sitting there for 3 years. They hadn't done an inventory. Nobody knew what was there. And so Kathleen finally persuaded this wonderful archivist to go down and open up the boxes and see what was in them. And lo and behold, there were five of these 8-track tapes. And across the five tapes were all but two of the songs that the band performed on the tour. And we were able to use those in our film. And Bobby Colombi and a great engineer named Alan Sides went into Capitol Studios here in Hollywood, where Frank Sinatra used to record, and mixed these tapes. So it sounds as if they were just recorded yesterday. And when your listeners go to Hot Docs and see the film, they're going to have this sound just blaring out of these speakers in the theater, and it's just going to be in your face, and it's going to be fantastic.
Ted Walshen returns in a moment.
Have you been tasked with the role of a state executor, or expected maybe in the future you will be? Well, if so, let me make your life a lot simpler by introducing you to my friend Debbie Stanley. Debbie is the founder of ETP Canada. They specialize in estate administration. Their goal simply is to help Canadian executors understand their role and how to deal with a loved one's estate. Let's face it, there's no school for this. But ETP Canada offers services such as executor support, estate accounting, and they have a new online course called Executor Ready. It's an engaging video designed to make estate administration easier and affordable. And those are two comforting thoughts during a stressful time. So call Debbie Stanley at 1-866-309-0387. That's 1-866-309-0387. Or you can get her at info@etpcanada.ca. That's info@etpcanada.ca. Do you have an upcoming wedding on your calendar? Hey, it's Ted Walshen for Tom's Place. If you're the father of the bride or a special guest who needs an elegant new suit or tuxedo, Tom will help you get ready for the spotlight. And if you're the lucky groom, Tom is a friend of the groom and the best man to help you dress the entire wedding party for your special day. Whether it's formal or informal, destination wedding, traditional or contemporary, tailored suits, or classic tuxedos with all the accessories, why rent a tux when it's so affordable to buy a classic that'll take you to events for years to come? Find out more at Tom's Place in Kensington Market. No one can dress you better or save you more than our wedding specialists. And don't forget, enter our wonderful wedding contest at toms-place.com to win a $500 credit for your wedding party outfits. Tom's Place will suit you.
just had love before. Got mad and closed the door. But you said, child, just once more. I chose you for the one. Now we're having so much fun. You treated me so kind. I'm about to lose my mind. You made me so very happy. I'm so glad you came into my life.
Now back to Ted Walshin.
So the tour wraps up, and on paper, it's a great success. The crowds love it. For the purposes of the State Department, the propaganda works. Perhaps it would lead to better relations with these countries. But the band returns back to the United States, and it's nothing but negatives from both sides, from the left and the right, and the media. Everybody's turned against the band.
Absolutely right. You know, Ted, you'll know this from your long and distinguished career in radio. You know that sometimes bands have a moment. Mm-hmm. Everything's working great for them. Reviews are great. People are showing up for the concerts. They're in demand for TV. Everybody's talking about them, and everything is positive. And that's where Blood, Sweat, and Tears was before this tour happened. But even one change in that can diffuse the moment. And that's what happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears. When they came back, everybody turned against them on both sides. And that's what makes it unique. I mean, today, usually if you're going to get criticized politically, it's either from one side or the other. They got it from both sides, as you say. And yeah, that makes their situation unique. And what it did was to just bring their forward motion to a halt. And the right wing was against them because here they are speaking out against Nixon in the war, and how dare they? They're communists, whatever. And then the left is after them because they come back saying, you know, it's not so great over there. As bad as it is here, we really like America. And that didn't go over too well with the left wing. And yeah, so that moment disappeared. Yes, they continue to record. Yes, they continue to do concerts. For some years, actually. But what it really did was fracture the band and stop their momentum. And they did all those other things, but it was never the same.
There's a story, and correct me if I'm wrong, that when the band was playing after they'd returned from their tour at Madison Square Garden, Abby Hoffman threw a bag of horse manure on stage.
Yes, not him personally, but one of his followers did.
One of his
Abby was
followers.
Abby Hoffman, for your listeners, was one of the leading radicals here in America from the late 60s through the early 70s. And we talk a bit about him and his role in that. And we also talk about what happened at Madison Square Garden. There was no film shot or video shot that night. But we found a really fun, interesting way to dramatize that in the film and bring that moment to life. But I think as a metaphor, that speaks to what Blood, Sweat, and Tears encountered when they came home, is people threw shit at them.
Yeah. Yeah. It's incredible. Now, they still released an album afterwards, which was fairly successful from what I recall, right?
What happened while they were on the tour, BS&T 3 came out.
Right, okay.
And it did well, had a couple of singles that did okay, not as good as the second album, the first one with David Clayton Thomas. And then BS&T 4 came out, had a hit single on it, album didn't do quite as well. And then David left the band for a while, and they had another singer. And again, that also contributed to things not being the same.
Right. We should point out for the younger listeners who aren't familiar with exactly how popular Blood, Sweat, and Tears were, they beat out the Beatles' Abbey Road for a Grammy. Now, when I read that, I had to read it. I had to reread it like three times. I went, wait a minute. Like, Abbey Road is considered by many to be one of the greatest rock albums of all time.
You bet.
Right?
And not only that, Ted, they beat out a Johnny Cash album, Live at San Quentin. Oh, they beat out Crosby, Stills, and Nash. And several other well-known groups. But that's how popular they were at the time. And their demographic was quite broad. Older, younger, white, black, you name it. They brought in a very broad audience, which accounted for why they were so popular.
Well, you mentioned earlier in the interview that they had played it, they were about to play at the Newport Jazz Festival. They did end up playing at the Newport Jazz Festival. And they were one of those bands that could cross over because they were a fusion band, right? It's kind of a jazz rock thing happening here. They weren't Hendrix, although Hendrix, I think, played at Newport as well. And what stands for jazz festival nowadays is like virtually anything, you know. It doesn't really have to be jazz per se. But Blood, Sweat, and Tears was one of those kind of a crossover band in that sense.
Very much so. They were the first band to blend jazz and rock. And they did so in such a dynamic way that it influenced many horn bands and actually many other bands that came after them, but certainly Chicago and some of the others. But they also were darlings of the rock set. We talk in our film about how they were one of the headliners at the legendary Woodstock Festival.
But they weren't in the film, though.
They weren't in the film, and that's therein is a tale that we tell in our film as to exactly why they weren't. But we found a piece of film of them performing at Woodstock that no one has ever seen, and that again goes back to the detective work. But there's a whole fascinating story about why they weren't the only one. I mean, Creedence Clearwater Revival, Grateful Dead, Janis Joplin. The band, a lot of those famous acts of the time weren't in the film. But those have come down to us in other ways. But because of what happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears, they haven't. And so the impact on them of not being in the film was much greater.
After David Clayton Thomas left the band, did he return at one point, or was there an attempt for him to return? Was there an attempt for the band to get back together and to try to pick up the momentum?
He had left the band at the end of 1971 and went off to start a solo career.
Right.
He put out a couple of albums, but by the end of 1974, I think there was interest on his side and on the band's side about having him come back to Blood, Sweat, and Tears, which he did at the end of 74. And in 1975, they put out a new album that I think is terrific. It's called New City. And it had a lot of the same sort of energy and focus and good material that the earlier albums had had. But their time really had passed. Disco had come in. Some other developments happened, and I think they had been away too long. So they did three albums with David, and then Bobby left the band, and David took over. And until about 2004, he toured with, it was David Clayton Thomas and Blood, Sweat, and Tears, traveled the world, and then David let that go in 2004. And there actually still is a Blood, Sweat, and Tears out there performing today all around the world. None of the original members are in it, but it's that same sound. A lot of the band's repertoire, but also some other more contemporary songs in the same style.
Well, there's a lot of bands that are still performing. Chicago still performs. I don't know how many original members of Chicago there still are, but they're still out there performing as well.
Yes,
and I wonder about the new audiences. My guess is it's probably older fans that are going to see them, but the ones who weren't familiar with the original Blood, Sweat, and Tears, I'm wondering what they think, what their thoughts are of this band. Had they been able to put one up against another, like if you got to go to see the Blood, Sweat, and Tears that's touring now, and you get to see what the hell happened to the Blood, Sweat, and Tears documentary, and you think to yourself, wow, this is the way it should be.
You know, it's interesting. Bobby Columbi is fond of saying that the band today is much better players than the band back then. I'm not sure I agree with that. I think any of your listeners who come to see what the hell happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears are going to see a band at the peak of their powers. This was a great band, great players. Every instrument is terrific. And then you have David Clayton Thomas as the voice.
Yeah.
Unusual, unique, powerful voice, great singer, who brought something really special to all those songs. And it's tough to find a voice like that. If they grew on trees, there'd be a lot of popular groups around. and what David brought to the band is something really special. And so in my opinion, there's something really unique about this iteration of Blood, Sweat, and Tears that was around from late 1968 through late 1971.
What the hell happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears is currently running at the Hot Talks Ted Rogers Cinema here in Toronto. The producer and director, John Scheinfeld, is my guest. This is not your first foray, to say the least, into the world of music documentaries. As you mentioned, you did one on Mr. Coltrane called The Train?
Called Chasing Train.
Chasing Train. And then you did one on Harry Nilsson. Why is everybody talking about him? Because he had that great song, Everybody's Talking About Me.
Right. Who is Harry Nilsson? Why is everybody talking about him? And then there's another one I'm really proud of, The U.S. versus John Lennon, which was not a biography of Lennon, but it was an exploration of the political John Lennon. And how the Nixon administration tried to neutralize him in the 70s and how he filed suit against the U.S. government. So playing a little bit in the same ballpark as What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears. But I love music and love great bands. And if there's a great story, not just a ordinary biography, but if there's
well,
a
that's
great
what I was
story
about to
there.
Say that yeah, you're not just doing a biography, you're not just doing a documentary. There has to be a hook to it, right?
Has to be a compelling story and a multi-layered story, which is what we have with the Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and I had with those other ones. It's just, you know, if you want people to come out and pay to see it on a big screen, and there's nothing like seeing these docs on a big screen.
Yeah.
Then the story really has to be strong enough and intriguing enough and powerful enough. Mm-hmm. So when I am starting, when I'm thinking about doing a film, I always have to say to myself, all right, what's the story? Is it strong enough, compelling enough? And then it's what you asked earlier. It's do we have the materials with which to tell that story? But for me, always starts with the story.
Up next, Elvis.
You've done your homework, Ted. We're just about finished. We're going to deliver it next month.
What's the hook?
But not an Elvis bio. It's a moment in time, much like What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears is a moment in time. It's that moment in time in 1968 where Elvis had become irrelevant. Mm-hmm. People weren't buying his records. People weren't going to see his movies. The Beatles, the Stones, and all those other great British invasion bands had overtaken him as the king of rock and roll, and people just didn't care.
Yeah.
And he did this TV show, which has come to be known as the 68 Comeback Special. And we're telling the true story of what happened behind the scenes and the impact that it had. And we're setting that against the social, political, and cultural landscape of 1968, which was quite a turbulent year for our country, for your country, and really for the world at that time. Mm-hmm. And I'm really excited about this one. We're still finishing it up, but I think it's going to be really entertaining.
Well, I'm curious about what could be so controversial about a television special, but you're obviously it's the backdrop is well, so we'll have to wait until that.
It's really the times that were controversial. What was so interesting about this was Elvis went from being irrelevant to being back up on top. Yeah. And it's how that happened that made it really, really interesting, given where he had been.
It's got to be one of the most painful things for an artist who has achieved such great stardom to suddenly look in the mirror and have to admit to yourself, you know what? I'm irrelevant.
It's got to be painful, and it has to take a real a strong psychological toll on you. You know, it's really interesting. Today, for your younger listeners, you know, a lot of these artists come and go pretty quickly. They'll have a couple of hits and then sort of disappear. And you have to have great respect for artists, whether it's a Beyoncé in contemporary terms or the Beatles and the Stones in more classic terms, who can maintain a career over a long period of time. It's really hard. Tastes change, technology changes, the culture changes, and they can have such an impact on an artist. Some are able to translate their work effectively to these changes, others are not. And so you have to have great respect for those who do. And the Elvis story is how, for at least a brief shining moment, he was able to do that.
Yeah. See, that's the one thing that the advantage that athletes have over musicians, because great athletes can still go on and become great coaches, great general managers, great team owners, but not necessarily musicians.
Right.
You can mentor. Yeah, for sure. But it's not quite the same, right?
Not quite the same. I mean, you know, I love one of Canada's great bands, the Guess Who.
Mm-hmm.
Terrific band. Had their moment about 8-10 years. One of the great singers, Burton Cummings, fantastic singer. But styles changed and they weren't as relevant as they used to be. But they had their moment. And I think, again, that's what happens with a lot of bands. They'll have a moment, whether it's a one hit, whether it's a few years, whether it's a decade. And then they can kind of work off of that because they have enough hits that they can keep playing. But maybe the new material doesn't strike the culture in the same way. Yeah. And that's a tough landscape to navigate for these artists. So how do you stay relevant? How do you stay current? How do you keep producing new material that will touch people?
Yeah, it's a good point. What the Hell Happened to Blood, Sweat, and Tears is at the Hot Dogs Cinema, the Hot Dogs Ted Rogers Cinema here in Toronto. Go see it. If you're a Blood, Sweat, and Tears fan, you'll love it. Even if you're not, you'll be fascinated by the story itself, as well told by producer and director John Scheinfeld. John, a real pleasure chatting with you. Let's do this again in a couple of years from now when the Elvis flick's ready to go.
I'd love to. Really enjoyed the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, that'll do it for yet another episode. Thanks very much for tuning in. And by the way, our website is up and running. It's www.tedwoloshin, that's W-O-L-O-S-H-Y-N, one word, .ca. You can access any episode you want from the last year and a half. And we'll have all kinds of more stuff as we begin to enlarge that particular website, but it's up and running, so check it out and pass on to all your friends, and even those people who aren't your friends. And in the meantime, have a great week.
The Ted Wallisham Podcast has been brought to you by ETP Canada, providing estate administration with ease, and Tom's Place, for the finest in men's clothing at unbeatable prices. It's Tom's Place at 190 Baldwin in the heart of Kensington Market. Tom's Place will suit you. The Ted Wallisham Podcast is produced by Becky Coles. That's me. Technical production by Paul Gatt. Music by Bike Thieves. To talk to Ted and for more information on his podcast and our sponsors, go to www.tedwallisham.ca.